In this video, we're solving a perfectly inelastic collision between two carts. So we're given the masses of these carts and the initial velocities. They happen to be aiming at each other in the initial state for the system. And we're answering a whole list of questions here. So we're going to start by finding the final velocity of these carts after they're stuck together. That's what a perfectly inelastic collision means. As it turns out, there's always energy lost in a perfectly inelastic collision. So in part B, we're going to find out how much. And then we look at the impulse experienced by each cart during the collision. So that's the change in momentum for each individual cart. And knowing the impulse together with the time for the collision, which was given as 1/20th of a second, we can find the average force experienced by each cart. And then we hope that that's consistent with Newton's third law. In other words, the forces should be equal in magnitude, but opposite in direction. So we start with the final speed question. And to get this done, we're using the fact that momentum is conserved in the collision. So we have P initial is equal to P final. Now, momentum is a vector, but in a one-dimensional setting, we'll keep track of direction by using plus and minus signs. So in the initial state, we have a momentum for the 2.5 kilogram cart given by the mass of that car times its velocity. So that's a positive 1.4 meters per second. Again, using the positive quantity to indicate rightward movement. Now the momentum of the 1.5 kilogram cart, I can write this as plus 1.5 kilograms times its negative velocity of 1.6 meters per second, where that minus sign indicates leftward motion. In a perfectly inelastic collision, the two carts stick together and they're going to travel with some final velocity. So the total mass when I put the carts together is 4 kilograms, and that final velocity is our unknown. So we just have to simplify everything on the left side of that equation. Note there that the units are kilogram meters per second, and then we're going to divide by the 4 kilograms, giving us units of meters per second. Into 3 significant digits, this gives us a final velocity of 0.275 meters per second. So in part B, we want to compute the energy lost in this collision. So what we do is look at the initial kinetic energy of both moving cars here, and then we'll find the final kinetic energy of the stuck together cars now that we know how fast they're going. And then we'll just look at the difference there to find out how much energy was lost. So in our initial state, we have 1/2 times mv squared for the 2.5 kilogram car. So there's m, 2.5, and v was 1.4. And we add that to the kinetic energy of the second car, 1/2 times 1.5, and then it had a speed of 1.6, so 1.6 squared. And this gives us a total energy of 4.37 joules. Now we look at the final state, where we can just treat this as a single 4 kilogram mass. So we have 1/2 times 4 times our final speed that we computed in part A, that was 0.275 squared. And this gives us about 0.15 joules. In other words, almost all the energy was lost in this collision. So we take the difference between these numbers, and we find that 4.22 joules was lost. So next in part C, we're going to find the impulse experienced by each of these individual carts. So impulse is just a name for the change in momentum. So the impulse experienced by cart number one here, that's the 2.5 kilogram cart, is going to be the final momentum of that particular cart minus its initial momentum. So I'm going to say P1 final minus P1 initial. So the final momentum of this cart, that's happening when it's stuck to the second cart. But we're still talking about just that mass of 2.5 kilograms and that final speed of 0.275 meters per second. And then we subtract from that the initial momentum for that car, which was a 2.5 times 1.4 meters per second. This gives us a change in momentum, or an impulse, of negative 2.81 kilogram meters per second. So now we do the same thing for cart number two. So that's the 1.5 kilogram cart. Again, the impulse is just the change in momentum. So that's going to be P2 final minus P2 initial. And our final momentum for that cart is given by mass. That's 1.5 kilograms times its final velocity, which was a positive 0.275. And the initial, we need to be really careful on this because it initially had a negative momentum. So we're subtracting P2 initial, but remember P2 initial carries a minus sign because it has that initial leftward pointing velocity. So we end up with a double negative on that term. and we end up with an impulse experienced by this car of positive 2.81 kilogram meters per second. And notice what happened there. One of the impulses was negative, one of them was positive, and they have exactly the same magnitude. And this is just because momentum is a conserved quantity. The sum of all the changes in the momenta in a problem should add up to zero, provided there's no net external force on the system. Okay, finally, the impulse experienced by each of these carts, together with the time for the collision, allows us to find the average force experienced by each one of the carts during the collision. So the force experienced by the first cart, we'll just call that F1, is going to be the impulse experienced by that cart, delta P1, divided by the time it took, and that's delta T. So we take that negative 2.81 kilogram meters per second impulse. That's a leftward change in momentum for that initially moving to the right car. Divided by the time for the collision, 0.05 seconds. And notice this gives us units of kilogram meters per second squared. That's units of mass times acceleration, so units of force. And we get an average force of negative 56.3 newtons on this cart. And I just want to point out that I kept all the precision in my calculator from the impulse calculation in the previous step. If you use the rounded number of 2.81, you would have got 56.2 newtons instead. Okay, and then we do a similar thing for the second cart. But look what's going on with the numbers here. We're going to take an impulse, delta P, with exactly the same magnitude. It's just a plus sign instead of a minus sign. And we're dividing by the same collision time, delta T. So we know we're going to end up with the same magnitude for F2, and that's 56.3 newtons, but this time we have a plus sign on it. And so this is a good thing. We see Newton's third law coming out of this. When these two cars crash into each other, they experience forces that have the exact same magnitude, but opposite directions. If you enjoyed this video, or at least found it useful, check out another one by clicking one of the links on the left. Or click the Zach's Lab logo on the right to explore dozens of physics and math playlists. As always, you can leave your questions, comments, and requests in the comments section below, and I'll get back to you within 24 hours. Thanks for watching Zach's Lab, and best of luck on your math and physics journey.